You know, Paul, you got a handful of Republican governors that are considering turning down some of the money the federal stimulus package offers them. I mean, it's nothing but a grandstand political play. But I just love the way you handled this issue is, you know, don't take the money.
Well, right. This is an economic choice. This is not a moral matter. You know, when I was a kid, you were a kid in the South, segregation was around. It was evil. The nation said it must stop, and it did. Well, this is not a moral crisis. This is just an economic crisis. And if these Republican governors believe that investing in their state's schools and health care and smart energy grid will hurt their state, well, then, my goodness, let's not do it.
I love the way you handled it with Sanford. I mean, you know, here you point out you got South Carolina, Mark Sanford. This is a state so dependent on welfare. I mean, call it what you want. They are dependent on government bailout and have been forever. And now this guy's saying, no, I don't think I want this money.
And you watch him take it. You know, this is the thing. They want the best of both worlds. They want to run around and say they're against spending, but they want the money for their states or their districts. How about if we did this in Washington as well? What if we had reverse earmarks? That is, any congressman can put in the bill, none of this money comes to my district. Right? Why don't we do that? Well, if this is so damaging to our country, the Obama recovery plan, let's not force it on these Republicans. Let's just build up the parts of America that want to be built up.
Yeah, the analysis is too elegant, you know. But really, as you point out in your article and in the way you talk about this issue, it's really their way to deny the effectiveness of the New Deal. It's this old thing, you know, that they just can't get over FDR. It's just part of how they're built. And this is their way to do it. You know, it just doesn't work. Don't you see that that's kind of what we're seeing in this argument?
There is, of course, you know, as an attorney, there has been for many years in the legal community, in the far right, an attempt to dismantle the New Deal. Mm-hmm. In fact, President Bush put on the appeals court. Sure. A judge, Janice Rogers Brown, who basically said it was socialism,
of
the
course.
New Deal.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're seeing it moving into economic and political thinking, where my right-wing friends here in Washington say, well, the New Deal didn't work. Well, if it didn't, it was a darn good imitation of working.
You know, it sure fooled us for a long time, didn't
Roosevelt
it?
Roosevelt carried 46 out of 48 states.
Yeah.
In 1936 when he ran for re-election. If it wasn't working, he sure fooled all of the people all of the time.
You know, I heard you say one time that the only time, what proved it even more was when he backed off this
right.
idea of more spending for the states and more spending by the federal government, almost moved us back into the Depression, didn't it?
In fact, that's right. In 1937, right, Roosevelt came in 1933, and he enacted the New Deal, and unemployment dropped in 1934, 1935, 1936, and in 1937, having just been reelected with 46 states, he eased off. He gave in to those timid voices that said, well, let's not really invest so much in our people. And we brought a recession back.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he went back to the New Deal, and it continued to decline unemployment. It was still high. It was 10 to 12%.
Right.
And what got us out of it finally was World War II, which, in addition to saving the world from fascism, was the largest public expenditure in American history.
Yeah, yeah. So the Republicans of, as you put it, denial, delay, and do nothing. Paul, how is it that they get this in their head that this is good politics? Where does that come? Does it come from the idea that they're just so disconnected or that they're just so damn angry? What is it?
Yes, I think it's both. I think that they some of them are in the grip of a failed theory. They really believe their theory, and that's okay. But I think it's demonstrably failed them, right? President Bush, with a Republican House, Republican Senate, Republican White House, put Republican economics in and gave us this new Bush depression.
Mm.
But others of them are just, at least I can admire someone who has a theory that they believe and they stick to it, I suppose. But others are playing politics just raw and naked. They see this new president. They want him to fail. You hear Rush Limbaugh say this on the radio.
Mm.
I want our president to fail.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
You know, that's all. I guess it's. I wouldn't say it's un-American, but it's pretty darn unpatriotic.
Well, I think to me, and I know you've been around this for so long, but much longer than I have. But in the years that I've been doing this talk radio and talk television thing, I've never seen them angrier. I've never seen them. I can come off a Fox show these days And by the time I get to my car, I have 50, 60, 70 hate mail because they're so cornered. You know, they're so cornered. And this thing that's happening with these governors right now just enhances that. I mean, rather than saying, look, renewable energy is great, repairing roads is good, rebuilding bridges, modernizing the power grid, these are good things, updating health, health is a good thing. Rather than doing the obvious, they move to this Jurassic mentality. And I think it's out of anger more than anything.
I think that's a good point. It must be frustrating to, you know, to believe in something all your life and then see that it was wrong. You know, at some point, you know, people in my church, I'm a Catholic, we Catholics had to accept that Galileo was right 1,000 years ago and the Pope was wrong. But, you know, it probably hurt some feelings, probably made some people angry. It took 1,000 years to get around to it, or several hundred anyway. But, you know, we just had a failed theory. We were wrong.
Yeah.
Those are my theological predecessors. And I think that this is the same thing. This is you know, pre-Galileo economics. These are people who really believe the whole world revolves around an elite class, the Bernie Madoff-Kinley class. This is what they told us. If we target economic policy to a few elite investors, Mr. Madoff, Mr. Lay, and others, then all the rest of us will be okay because they're so wise. They will make the right decisions for us. And Obama, Clinton, they have a Democrats. You know, we have a different philosophy, which is I trust people more. And ordinary people, if we target our economic policy to what Bill Clinton used to call walking around folks, well, then the whole country will do better. And guess what? The rich will do better still. Bill Gates made his billions because middle-class people could afford to buy computers. And so it's better for everybody. I mean, I don't want to hurt anybody in this, but I just know that the way to make everybody richer is the way the president is trying to do it.
Is to have everybody do better. You know, one thing that's really troubling about this grandstand play by, you know, these governors like Jindal and Perry and Haley Barbour and,
right,
of course, you know, all the usual suspects, is they know that what's in place in this bill is that even if a governor objects, the lawmakers of that state can override. They can accept the money anyway. So it's almost like, you know, they're out there, they're spewing this right-wing crazy dogma that they still haven't gotten what happened to them the last two elections. So they're still talking those talking points. And in there, and most people don't realize this, I think it was Clyburn or somebody of South, put into the bill that it doesn't make any difference whether the governor wants the money or not. Lawmakers can override that and accept the money. So this is kind of the perfect world for them to kind of stand up and beat on their chest. It makes you proud of a guy like Charlie Crist, doesn't
right.
it?
Right. He's, you know, of course, the Florida governor, such a loyal Republican that John McCain almost put him on the ticket, but he's putting his state first. You know, and I admire that. He's saying, look, even before I'm a Republican, I'm a governor who's responsible for a bunch of cops and firefighters and teachers who I don't want laid off. I'm a governor who's responsible for a bunch of homeowners who are losing their home through no fault of their own. I'm the governor of a state that needs roads and bridges and renewable electricity. So I admire that. Now, we'll have our differences on other things, and that's how politics ought to work.
Well, you've got a few people. Sonny Perdue, of course, from Georgia. They're about $3 billion in the hole right now. What are they to do? I mean, they have to do what they know is in the best interest of that state.
Right. Well, I was just down there. I was quail hunting last week in Georgia with a bunch of friends of mine, and I was asking them how their governor's doing. And they said even as they rail against federal spending, they're holding the budget. They have a big hole in the budget that says, here comes federal money. And that's what most states are doing because they have to live in the real world. So I'm just trying to drag, you know, Brother Barbour and Brother Perry and Brother Sanford and some of these other ideological governors into the real world.